Chapman.
Here.
Councilmember Clayton.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Please stand for the silent prayer, a moment of reflection. We will now salute the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, PL 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster, and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Items for review, we are on to item A, City Manager's Report on Issue Raised at Prior Council Meeting.
There is none at this time, thank you.
Okay. Item B, Special Event Applications.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This evening we have three applications. First one being the Asbury Park Zombie Walk to be held on October 1st from the hours of 12 to 8. This will be the same as it has been in previous years, with the walk beginning at 4 on the boardwalk, headed south to Cookman and Cookman to Main. It should also be noted that Merchants Park will be fenced off, and if necessary, officers will be there to secure that no one goes in the park.
And we also said Press Plaza.
Yes.
The Environmental Commission just redid Press Plaza.
Yes, we will. Any questions on?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
A couple of questions about this. Is there plans to close down Cookman Avenue during the day? Because last year it was closed, and we know merchants weren't happy that the street was closed for the entire day.
Right. That is correct, and there are plans to close it as it was last year.
For the entire day, even though the parade doesn't start until 4 o'clock in the afternoon?
Well, that's something I think we could talk to the applicant about, maybe closing it for a shorter period of time versus all day.
Okay, I think we need to consider that.
Okay.
And the other issue is you're going to close the 700 block of Cookman Avenue from 4 to 7. Has there been any thought of maybe moving it to Madison where there aren't businesses, because that's a major thoroughfare,
mm-hmm.
and for getting in and out of the city and getting to restaurants and things?
Well, that has been discussed in the past. One of the things that was taken into consideration is that Johnny Mac is a sponsor, and he wants to encourage people to go to his restaurant, bar, after the event. So that's why he wanted, the request was made for Cookman to be closed, the 700
but
block.
Madison's right on the other side of Johnny Mac.
Okay. It's just a request of the applicant. It's up to the council if they want to approve it or not. So that's just a request.
To me, it would make more sense to close down Madison where there aren't businesses and it's an open block. You wouldn't be blocking the showroom and all the other businesses that are there on Cookman Avenue. And it's still on the same block. I mean, they're not saying that they won't have access to Johnny Mac.
Point taken.
That's my opinion. I don't know how anybody else feels, but that's what I think.
Okay. Any other questions or comments on this particular application? Okay, next is the Beer Run, which would be held on Sunday, October 9th. This will be done in conjunction with the Oktoberfest, which is sponsored by the Beer Garden. And lastly, we have a wedding on September 17th on 6th Avenue Beach at 4:30. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're on to item C, items to be presented by Mark Steinberg, Esquire.
See you in a month.
Okay, items to be presented by Asbury Park Fire Chief Kevin Ketty.
Was Steinberg the one you said you were going to withdraw something, 512 Summerfield or something? Is that the same one?
No, it's a different one. This has been on for about 2 months now.
Pardon?
Hasn't done anything.
No.
because even what was in our package wasn't signed by Mark Steinberg, it was signed by Andy Karas. So it's like, why is Mark Steinberg, who's not a partner with Andy Karas, representing Mark?
Andy was the other one.
But he wasn't listed.
He was on the first one. We took him off to that. Okay. Andy was a redevelopment plan amendment.
Okay, but there was nothing in our package about him?
No.
Okay.
One of the things that we've been talking internally about is the fire department and the police department are both using radio systems and radio equipment that will soon be outdated. Nationally, there's been a move to the 700 megahertz system, which involves upgrading radios and equipment. One of the things, especially in the police department, that we're working on right now is they have what's called a base system. And the base system is 28 years old, and in order to repair it, they get parts off of eBay. So one of the things that we've met with the county about and brought in a third-party vendor that I knew from my previous job was, what's the most cost-effective way to be able to meet the FCC requirements of moving up to the 700 megahertz system while providing, you know, cost-effective solutions with this? The police and fire departments have met repeatedly with the county, and there's going to be two things that need to be done. One, we're proposing upgrading the fire department and upgrading the police department and putting them both on the county system. Both systems are a little different because fire does a little bit things differently, but moving forward, it takes that cost out of our hands of maintaining that base system, which can go anywhere from $250,000 to $500,000, and putting us all on the county system. So Kevin's going to give a briefing right now of what the fire department is going to be requesting and needs to meet the requirements of fire and EMS in the short-term and long-term future.
Okay, good evening. Our current system was built out in 2007. We purchased then all new radios for the fire department in 2007. They've reached their useful lifespan. We're currently in a position where we don't have enough for everybody in the fire department. We had another one break today, and they're discontinued, and it's difficult to get parts. The current system is on the 150 megahertz system, which is the system that's being phased out. It's not interoperable with the Asbury Park Police Department or other county fire departments due to the design. It's outdated. Both Monmouth County technicians and the private contractor that the manager talked about have stated that they probably wouldn't be able to get parts for them when they break. We currently use one channel for all operations. We should have more than one channel for firefighter safety purposes. The system, because it's 100 in the 100 megahertz range, it doesn't work well in a lot of our bigger buildings. The 700 megahertz system penetrates buildings much better than usually the higher the megahertz, the better the penetration in the buildings. There is no coverage outside of Asbury Park because of the way the repeater system is configured. And currently we have 8 broken radios with no way to fix them. The proposed system would be completely maintained by Monmouth County. And when I say completely maintained, we wouldn't have to have antennas, repeater systems, or backup emergency power systems and things like that. As I said, the 700 megahertz system works much better in concrete and steel type buildings. We tested it extensively throughout town. It would be a single interoperable system with other county dispatch, police departments, fire departments, EMS agencies, and there would be full countywide coverage, including all hospital emergency rooms. In one instance, we were able to speak from the emergency room in Jersey Shore all the way to a home in Oceanport. With just the handheld radios, we would get a 5-year warranty, and by using the economies of scale, we negotiated with Motorola and our neighboring fire department in Neptune, who is also switching over to the 700 megahertz system, along with all of the Monmouth County EMS agencies that are dispatched by the county. And Motorola is offering us a one-time 35% discount below state contracting. And the sheriff's department is also stepping up to the plate on the EMS side, which the Asbury Park Fire Department also does, and they're prepared to give us about $30,000 worth of new radios also.
Okay,
When you say it reached the usefulness of its lifespan, what does that mean?
They're
do
old.
They not work?
They're old and outdated, and when
but
they still work. They still work, but when they do break, the parts are discontinued, so they can't be fixed.
And why would you need coverage outside of Asbury Park?
When we leave Asbury Park and go to Jersey Shore for the hospital, or when we go to other towns on mutual aid runs, the way the fire department operates, we assist each other in times of need. For an example, every time we get a working fire in Asbury Park, we have outside agencies here. That's a two-way street. We were actually in Bradley Beach this morning. There was three houses on fire in Bradley Beach early this morning. So we cross the borders quite often.
And what did the previous system cost?
I don't have those figures. That was back in 2007. It was a combined effort between the police department and the fire department back then. But the police department quarterbacked the whole thing. I will say that back then when we bought the portable radios, they were approximately $2,000 a piece.
And that was the whole system?
No,
that was just a portion of it.
That was just each radio at that time was about $2,000.
I noticed that there are very few radios that we have now. I noticed that some of the specials only have one among them over the weekend or two.
Yes, right now the police department actually doesn't have enough radios to hand out all the specials. So the special twos were working with the special ones because that's the only radios that they actually had. So we were short this summer on radios as we hired more people, which is going to be another problem moving forward is those parts aren't available.
So how many are we talking?
Police department is still working through it. Police department has a bigger issue, as the chief had mentioned, about going into higher buildings. The police department wasn't able to get penetration. So right now we're looking for a vendor to do the study to see what would be needed if there's another repeater needed. Or if we can use our own equipment that we have and move it somewhere so that we can get the full coverage. The fire department has a little bit more of an advantage in a situation like that because they'll go to fire ground and talk one-on-one, almost like the old Motorola point, you know, where you like a walkie-talkie. Right. Police doesn't have that. So they have a little bit of advantage in the high-rise situations. All new buildings are required to have it. So the plans for 1101 Ocean have that in there. So that there is no coverage issues, but the police department has identified maybe three to six places that they don't get coverage, which is a problem, as you know.
Thank you.
So how many radios total are we talking about?
We are looking at 16 mobile radios, it's the kind that go into the vehicles, and 55 portable radios.
And that'll take care of everyone that take care of with this amount?
Yeah, that would take care of the fire department for the foreseeable future.
Okay. When we first started meeting about this, one of the things that we looked at is, does it make sense to have one radio across the board? And there's certain aspects, obviously fire department should have waterproof radios because that just makes sense. But the way that the fire department system is set up is that with Motorola, there's proprietary software just for them. So the getting one just general radio wouldn't work. So what happened was everyone took a look at what the standards are for those radios and parts-wise to make sure that, okay, if something goes down and you know they have a part that police doesn't have, we can work together and interdepartmentally be able to fix things, which doesn't happen now.
It is obviously something that's needed. It's obviously something we're going to go for, but it's not obvious that we've done it right in the past. In 2006, 2007, 2008, I worked for the city. And at the OEM center, there's 200,000, and I'm making up the numbers. So I always make up numbers and I get nailed in the newspaper. So don't quote me on numbers. There's X amount of thousands of dollars of equipment sitting in the OEM center at DPW that has dust on it this thick that has never been turned on because it was done wrong in the past. If you're going to do it right. That's not blue taxpayers' money. Let's make sure everything works. That's something being with the county scares me. A five-year what with the county guarantee?
No, the 5-year warranty.
Warranty.
Warranty on the new equipment.
And what happens if, just what happens to say, pray say down the road, 2 years from now, the county switches systems? Where are we stuck?
Well, the county just invested, and this is an all-in number, but they invested almost $40 million on their new communication center.
So there's no chance of that happening?
This is their system.
Okay.
So.
And one of the things that we were concerned about is, and that's why we brought in a third person to look at this when we sat there, was to make sure that this future is actually future-proof as best as possible, because you never know what's going to happen. The 700 megahertz channel isn't going anywhere. Where, like, you know, they're at 150 now, that's been changed. And one of the actually more interesting things, I see, you know, Councilwoman Clayton shaking her head yes, was Kevin, myself, and Salerno were talking about it, and the councilwoman showed up in City Hall and said, do you want to sit down and talk about this? And she knew exactly what we were talking about from her private sector days. So she was like, no, I understand everything you're talking about. This is, the change has to happen because they're changing the systems. It was an FCC mandate. And then the county was ahead of the curve on it. So right now we're behind the curve. And the police, when they were testing it, I mean, as Kevin said, it was crystal clear in Old Bridge, our channels. So that's helpful, especially in an event. But we want to make sure it's done right. And we're bringing in multiple people to look at it.
That's the key.
Yeah, I think we're all for it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And if yours are bringing down all the time, the quicker we do it, the better. So I don't know. Does the fire department have to wait on the police department? Obviously, this is going to be a capital purchase because this is going to be, I'm up guessing, $1 million paid off over 10 years, so $100,000 a year, which won't affect taxes and the budget. But how do we get the fire department online as quick as possible, hearing how much Kevin's equipment's
breaking down? We have they're working on the quote from the fire department. So what we would propose is the capital ordinance for the second meeting of the month. And go higher than we need to, just to make sure, in case something, especially since we don't know what repeaters or towers we might need, because those things can cost anywhere from $5,000 to $15,000. So go high, and, you know, obviously we proactively manage things now. We have the full-time CFO. We cancel things, which you're seeing on tonight's agenda. Have a higher number so that they can get in their 25%, additional 35% off, and the police department will follow behind. One of the key things is that from the county side, they would like all EMS to be on this system by the end of the year. And Motorola is giving a fantastic discount because, you know, Kevin worked with other towns and talked to other towns about, hey, 50 to 100, 100 to 200, you're now starting to see some economies. And Kevin did reach out to three or four other places to see if they wanted to go on this too.
Well, hearing how much our equipment is breaking down, I would like to see it online before the end of the year, if that's possible, so.
It's just, it waits upon them.
And you talk about the repeaters now, and I know nothing as far as technology, but I know we have repeaters. We have one on Robinson Towers, we have one on Monroe Towers, we have one on Phillips Seaview Tower, and probably one on 1801 Ocean. Just throw those away and get new repeaters, or do repeaters like last forever?
It depends, and that's what the study is going to tell us.
Okay.
Yeah. These guys aren't as impacted at this point. The police are, and so the police obviously want to make sure that they have coverage there.
Okay.
No, I got that. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're on to item D, review of agenda items for September 14th, 2016 regular meeting.
Do you just want me to go through some of the more technical ones first? Because I heard from three of you today who had all the same questions. So I'm going to assume that not only the other two are going to have the questions, but the public in general.
Sure. Okay.
Resolution 2016-359 is a resolution canceling balances of reserve for unappropriated grants. These are cleaning up the books. We don't have this money. We never had this money. This is just grants that the city had applied for, might not have received, or done years ago. These go back at least 7 or 8 years. That never actually sought the receivable. And, like, for example, there's one for EDA. I'm just using this as an example. EDA wouldn't have that money available now if we tried to get it anyway. So we're cleaning up the books. We've already either done a project or haven't gotten it. But these are stuff that's just been sitting open in the books and needs to be cleaned up. It's an accounting process. The dedication by riders. There's three resolutions, 2016-363, 364, and 365. A dedication by rider, again, we're cleaning up stuff that wasn't done in the past. The dedication by rider is if your budget's adopted and you get a donation. Say there's a donation in for $1 million for their radio equipment. What we would need to do is we need to have a mechanism to spend that money. The dedication by rider puts a rider on the budget and allows us to legally spend the money. So over the last couple of years, there was no dedication for the senior center, national night out, or police community relations. So this establishes those accounts so that we can legally spend the money. We already have the money, we just can't legally spend it. Resolutions 2016-371 and 372 is authorizing the refunds of security deposits paid for vendors at the transportation center. When the city originally bid this out 5.5-6 years ago, a security deposit was due. Now we give it back, since there's a new contract, simple as that. There's new security deposits required. When these contracts are up, we give it back. Resolution 2016-374 is authorizing an application for non-federal cost share program. This is a Sandy related resolution. Category A, which was debris removal, and category B, which is proactive protective measures. The state has instituted a program that will allow municipalities to recoup the 10% local match. So in categories A and B, the city spent approximately $800,000. We can now apply for a grant from the state to get 10% back. So this resolution authorizes us to do the grant application to possibly get $80,000 back. It'll be myself and Tracy Lizardi who will do most of the work with it. It's a 5-page application. It won't take us more than an hour or two.
So this is retroactive to Sandy?
This is retroactive to Sandy. It shouldn't take more than an hour or two to get this done. So we hope to have it done by the end of the month. Tracy and I have already talked about it, already reviewed the application she was in last week. It's pretty simple.
Okay.
Resolution 2016-376 is a resolution to join the New Jersey Sustainable Energy Joint Meeting, or the SEM, as I usually call it. The city currently uses EMEX to purchase third-party electric, which is at a cheaper rate. We've had some problems with EMEX and their provider, Hudson Electric. The New Jersey SEM has the same, if not lower, rates for electric and natural gas. Additionally, joining the SEM would give us Sustainable New Jersey credits as we move towards trying to get that reinstated. So this is one of the cost-saving measures of stabilizing energy, electric uses and charges that we did. The city should have done this about 3 years ago through EMEX, but I don't know, I never found a resolution. Resolution 2016.
Do we have any, comparing ourselves to other towns that have done this, do we have any projected what this is going to save us?
Right now it would be a small amount if we switched. As of today, it would be about 2% on a bill. The SEM is going back out to bid in November, and they've picked up another, I think, 10 or 15 clients to have a bigger therm as they go out to bid. They're the largest one right now. Resolution 2016-377 is authorizing the acquisition, support, and maintenance of proprietary software. This is through Capital. This is our performance metric software so that we can have a better understanding of what we do and how we do it. For example, we don't have a method to track summer rec kids. We don't have a method to, unless we hand count them, to track marriage licenses or how much tonnage we use for pothole filling, how many EMS calls, what the construction code revenue building permit numbers are. This will allow us to be able to aggregate that data, look for trends, look for financial trends. The staff has seen it. They all liked it. So we're recommending moving forward with this.
So I just had some questions on that. It says in the proposal, samples but not limited to, and it names some of the things you just named, pothole repairs, street sweeping, snow removal, all of that. So is there something that we could do? I guess my point to you is, like, I have some specific things I'd want to add to that list.
This shouldn't be an issue. As long as it be quantified, it can be done.
Like light repairs, like when lights go out and we repair them. What's that? Can we quantify that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, it's actually also, as part of it, he does a work order system, and everything's online. It's all done through Google Docs, and he puts the SQL database online. So this is something that once we get it up and running, it can be put on the website forward facing so people can see, you know, what's going on with aspects of what we're doing, especially pothole repair.
So that means if somebody makes a complaint about a pothole, they can go online and
they have that now, but it sort of gets stuck in our system. This will be more internal for that. There is the reporter problem on the website, but there's issues with it. Sometimes it gets out of their system. It's stuck in the eGov system. I know Hannah has been working with them over the last couple months to get that fixed, but it's their programming, it's not us. But it'll allow someone to see, you know, what we do and how we do it.
And they'll see the status.
That it should.
Okay, so I'll just email you a couple of other ones and we can talk about
anything and everything. How many social services people see, anything that can be quantified, we can do.
And then the other thing is, so it looks like members of the department input the information?
Yes, it's simple, it's in Excel. So then it just gets sent over to the company and they just put it together using SQL.
And then do we designate people in those departments to input it?
Yeah, it's just who's ever doing whatever. Like Kevin's software, he can export to Excel. So then Kevin could just send it right up to Sean. For like summer, for summer recreation, there isn't that database created. So Sean said he'll sit down with Leisha, figure out how to do the good and nice easy form, and then just run it from there. So it's going to improve our operations across the board.
Would you let me know when that's happening?
Yeah. Thank you. Within the next 2 or 3 months, we hope to get everything, you know, nailed down.
Michael, and then are there reports that can be generated from this?
All the time. Real-time, live reports at any point in time.
And who's running the show on this? You?
And then the departments.
Okay.
Sean, you know, he's met with some of them already, he's had conversations with them. So, yeah, there hasn't been any issues.
And who has access to those reports?
Anyone we give access to.
Okay.
So I'm going to use a previous example. So when Steve K was the clerk, he wasn't hugely
he wasn't
technologically advanced. So if you asked him to input that, that might be a struggle. So I guess what I'm trying to say to you, Michael, is I think you should identify specific people in the department to do the input.
Oh, yeah, this is, yeah. The next one that there might be questions on is 2016-379, which is a modification of the agreement with us and the Housing Authority. There's no money involved whatsoever. It cleans up the process of what's going on with them receiving the grant money. It articulates that they're under a Section 31 review, which goes right to the Planning Board. There's no money involved in this. It's administrative in nature. And then 2016-383 is resolution authorizing a lien. You'll have the paperwork on that tomorrow. It's still being worked on. But Mr. Sackman and Johnny Mack's building, as we've all known, there's been issues there. They've called us in. We've gotten into the middle of it with our structural engineer.
What number are you on?
383. You don't have this one yet. Because we don't have the block and lots. I didn't have the block and lots ready. Because it's the middle one, which is its own separate lot, and we didn't have it yet. So this will put a lien on their property to cover our expenses, because the structural engineer has been out there probably about 15 hours, has issued 2 reports on it, and we shouldn't be paying for their errors and their inability to figure out and solve a problem. So this is once we get the cost, it's going to authorize Fred to be able to put the liens on the properties until this is solved.
On both their properties? Both Johnny?
Split the cost evenly.
So can I go back to 216-375?
Is he done?
Oh, no. You're going to go through ordinances first? He's done with the resolution.
I can do 2016-375 is authorizing a one-year extension for private collection of municipal court debt. Currently, we have about $2.5 million of outstanding court debt. Last year, over the last 18 months or so, this company's collected $40,000 of it. I've talked to numerous municipalities. This seems to be the average. Our RFP was comparable to everyone else's RFP, so we don't know how to make this any better. The state has actually said that we don't have to do this anymore. This was part of being a transitional aid because the results weren't what everyone thought it was going to be. But it doesn't cost us anything. They're paid out of what they collect. So for now, I say just do a one-year extension. We're getting something for this until we can find a better way to get the $2.5 million that we're owed. Which I don't know if right now if there is.
So we're just extending the contract
for 1 year.
Right.
Do you want to do it for 1 year since you're profoundly unhappy with their performance? You want to do 6 months and then try to find somebody else to do it?
The RFP said 1 year.
Okay.
So, and 40,000 in the year, in 2 years of $2.5 million.
No. It sounds like it's a pretty, so that's my logic in not doing a year, right? Because it sounds like they do, the collection rate is
horrible.
Yeah.
I've been talking to a bunch of other people and we're all facing the same thing.
Okay.
Right, it's not just Asbury Park, it's statewide.
Okay.
And that's why when Tim Cunningham became the director of Division of Local Government Services, he asked us, like, what do you think about this? And he said, worst thing he ever did. And that's why he's not making other towns do it, because they also, like, $2.5 million, fine, we'll get $500,000 of it. No, it took Fred a year to get it through the process of going through
the administrative office of the courts.
Right, the courts, and we collected $40,000. So that's why it's no longer part of the MOU, because the state realized it wasn't a golden parachute they thought it was. And there's no other companies out there banging down the door saying, we can take your 40 to 80 or your 40 to like 50.
There's been nothing.
There's nobody else out there.
Right, and I'm sure I'm off on this. Kevin, the fire department has a collection company that collects for...
EMD.
Okay, and they do a pretty good job, don't they?
They do. Comparatively speaking, to who they have before, they do an excellent job.
Okay.
But it's different. It's medical billing. It's really not what they do. That's what they do.
They're going after people they can actually find, where the courts are going after people that they live in Texas, they live in Alabama. I mean, yes.
I would think this would be a lucrative thing for somebody to do.
Well, find us the company, we'll switch tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. Sorry, that was it for resolutions. For me.
Are we talking about 1101 today?
No, that's closer to death.
Everybody ready to move on?
No.
No?
I'm waiting for Yvonne.
Okay.
To see what she has.
Grant. I'm sorry.
Take your time. You want me to ask a couple while you're looking?
Most of my questions have been answered. I did have a question about 2016-381 and why this was included if we're not actually appointing someone.
We just put it there to have it there in case someone was appointed. I just had to make choices. So if you don't make someone, just there.
Okay, and ordinance 2016-35?
Ordinance 2016-35 is a capital ordinance appropriating a sum of $87,000 for acquisition of various capital items and park improvements. This is a capital surplus ordinance. What happens with capital surplus, it's an interesting endeavor that the city, if had been better managing its debt, would have had some more money in the past. When you do a capital ordinance, you have to do a 5% down payment. So $100,000, you need $5,000. So say the city approves the ordinance, there's $5,000 sitting there, they get a grant, they don't need to spend that $5,000. If the city had canceled that capital ordinance, that $5,000 comes back. In a nutshell, it would come to capital surplus. There's some technicalities of it, which I'm not going to bother getting into, but that $5,000 then comes back to us. If you spent $50,000 of that ordinance, then technically you only need $2,500, and that $2,500 comes back. So over the course of time, what you want to do is actively manage your capital ordinances and cancel them, because one, it gets your debt level reduced because you don't have that much out there, but you also then get your cash back. And the cash back then can be used for other items. So we went through, and this was one of the things that, you know, the audit had been mentioned over the last couple of years. We went through and Kaplan had found an ordinance from 08 that could have been canceled for money. I then double checked, found something from 03, and then Joanne, the CFO, found something from 1994. So you're dating back to cash was sitting there available for the city to use for other capital improvements going back almost two decades. So we took a bunch of those ordinances that had $10 here, $20 here, you're making up the numbers, and it came to $87,000. So the $87,000 we then want to reinvest on stuff that we need here. Most of our filing cabinets are putrid, most don't lock, none are fireproof, so we obviously want to upgrade some of those. Furniture needs to be upgraded. If you ever saw the treasurer, he actually works at a table, not a desk, which I don't even understand that. And we are in dire need of a folding machine, because what happens now is when Ed does all the check run, which is a couple hundred checks, he sits there by hand and folds them and stuffs them. And when we do the tax billing, it's all done by hand by the tax department. So all five of them sit there and do it by hand. And this year, two of them were out, and Tyrone made his 19 and 14-year-old son and daughter come and stuff envelopes all day. So we'd be able to speed up the process by buying a good, solid envelope folding and stuffing machine instead of having five people do this a couple times a year. Ed doesn't have to sit there and stuff envelopes by hand for an entire day. It's just something that I've always liked to use capital surplus as the wish list items, that this is something that, you know, is going to make us operate better. Getting James out of a table onto a desk would be nice. Getting some filing cabinets that locked and are fire resistant for marriage license, public employees records. It's a good step to actually operating normal.
Mike, how about a paint job for your office?
I've grown accustomed to the salmon or burnt skin color, so that would be nice at some point too.
Yeah, okay.
I wish.
He's already said that.
No surplus, okay. All right, thank you. That's it for me.
355. And it says 356.
Oh.
Is no 356, so explain 355, please.
355 is a resolution to amend the budget, and 356 is adoption of the 2016 municipal budget. We've received this transitional aid amount of $1 million. We'd asked for 1.2, so we've had to make some amendments to the budget. We're working through that right now with Tina, who's the Assistant Director of Local Government Services on the financial side of things, to get the budget balanced and complete. We should have it done tomorrow. Joanne was tweaking the last two or three things that Tina had wanted. So what this means is it's just a resolution adopting the final budget. There's no public hearings on this. It's already been held. We're pushing to get this done tomorrow for billing purposes. If this waits until the 28th, we're going to be hard pressed to get the bills out before tax sale might be due in November 11th. It's going to be very, very tight. So this is going to, what the amendment is looking like right now is we're going to bring over approximately $230,000 of fund balance, which will reduce the fund balance. It won't hurt us that much moving forward, but it'll balance the budget for this year. And then there's some little technical things here and there, which we'll give you a list of once it's finished with Tina and Joanne. But these are, again, we don't have the data yet. We've been working on this since Friday.
So we're looking to do that Wednesday?
Yes. If the concern that I have is if we do it on the 28th, that only gives us a couple days to get all the certifications, the state, the county, and then get bills out. Under the law, you have to have a bill out for 25 days.
I have no problem doing it Wednesday, but then I think somebody, be it you, Joanne, somebody should be here and make a budget presentation. Here's what we did back in April.
That's not a problem.
We had to wait for state aid, and here's the impact, and the taxes are staying the same. There's no
impact on taxes.
There's no impact on taxes. Everything's fine. And how we move the money around, but I think that should be.
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay.
That's no issue.
368, 369. These are two properties that are in the waterfront redevelopment zone where the owners have said, we've capped our sewer lines and we're never going to build there again. So now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when none of us are here and somebody wants to go build a hotel there, and they said, well, we don't want to pay a sewer connection fee because we still have the old sewer line. Where is that recorded so we do a better job than we have in the past as far as sewer connection fees?
This is recorded. Obviously, now it's a resolution, so it's a permanent record by the clerk. The tax collector gets a sample of this, gets a copy of the resolution. And in our financial software, Edmunds, we actually upgraded it in January. And the upgrade allows us to scan documents and attach it to the file. That was one of the requests that I had. We wanted to do the end of year rollover. And Tyrone, the tax collector, has been using it extensively. He used it in his last town. So anytime we have these resolutions, they're actually scanned into our financial software, which is now being backed up a couple times a week, so that it's attached to the property.
Okay, good. So
we're moving forward with it.
What happened in the past won't happen again.
That's minimalized now. We shouldn't have those issues.
Okay. And then 382 is 10. The in rem foreclosure. I thought we had already done this, but then I'm reading like we said to do it. So this just is formalizing to start the process.
We adopted a resolution relating to only one property.
Right.
There was a list. It's not with this package, but it was a double-sided list that had a picture of each property and all the information. And council had indicated that they would like the city to move forward, not just with the one property that was originally approved by resolution, but actually with all properties that had taxes due and owed in excess of $5,000. And actually every one of the properties that was on that double-sided sheet had taxes due and owed in excess of $5,000. So this resolution would authorize us to move forward subject to direction from the city manager with any or all of those that have taxes due and owed in excess of $5,000.
What we want to do internally is send out a letter to them first saying that this is what we're doing, because quite honestly it's cheaper than paying Fred to do it. And we'll send them a letter saying, you know, 15 weeks, tell us something that you want to do, because obviously there's going to be a cost and a delay of getting them posted in the foreclosure process. So we will be able to save a little bit of money by sending out the letter. We just haven't done it internally yet. And then moving on to Fred saying, excuse me, you haven't paid, what are you doing? We're gonna do something now.
But 1411 Memorial has already been started.
That's, yes. We've ordered title work, we're moving forward on that.
Okay, fantastic.
And what's better for the city actually is, although we've started the backup of doing the title work relating to that property, is we haven't filed on that one because it's more cost effective and efficient to include all of the properties in the same complaint. So when it was brought to my attention that we were actually thinking of other properties, we haven't moved forward to file the in-rem complaint on that property until we move forward.
Yeah, but, okay. But that, and I'm going to have the numbers wrong again, so don't anybody quote me. But that one's like 100,000, the rest are 5,000. Don't tell me we're waiting for $3,000 ones to move on $100,000.
No, we're looking for all. We're waiting for all. I mean, if you guys want to move forward, we can tell.
Yeah, we said in July, move okay. forward on 1411. Move forward on 1411. I mean, this has been an illegal nightclub, no mercantile license, breaking every law in the world, everything illegal going on there. We said, let's do it in July. Let's do it. I don't want to wait 3 more months for somebody else to look at 20 more properties.
We'll separate that
one. Okay.
That's easy.
Everybody correct me if I'm wrong, but I mean, I thought we made that clear back in July. Start this, and let's get the $100,000 they owe us, and let's move forward.
Yeah, that's no
problem. Or else let's take the property and sell it. Yeah, thank you. That's all I have.
On to item D. I'm sorry, item E, matters from the City Council.
I have nothing.
Today there was a luncheon in memory of Roy Wirtz, and Roy was the president of the board of the Chamber of Commerce for the city, a longtime resident, and someone who was a business owner on the boardwalk. And I just want to extend my condolences to his friends and his family and say that he will be dearly missed.
Jesse?
This past summer, which has just passed another week ago, we had some outstanding concerts at the Springwood Avenue Park, and I just think that I would be remiss if I just don't talk about it. We need this to continue, but I'd like to thank everyone that was a part of this and put in their time, their effort, the security, and the people that started. So I think I can just wrap it up with saying thank you and look forward to next year.
It was a great series.
And I know Michael I think you were on emails about this. So we're still getting complaints about the Asbury Hotel pretty repeatedly, and one of the suggestions was that the fines that we're imposing when we do summonses with them are too low, that they don't make any real, they're not a real incentive to turn the music down and make it manageable for people living in that area. And so the idea was to possibly increase those fines to make them more of a deterrent. Is that something that we can do?
My review of the nuisance section just referred the fines to the fine section, which I think is section 1.5 in the city code, which allows it up to $2,000 per instance. So that is entirely up to the judge to set the fine, because he has the $1 to $2,000 minimum maximum that the nuisance fine can be. If you want to do something moving forward of first offense is $1, second offense, second dollar, and make it where the judge doesn't have that sort of discretion, that might be advisable. But right now, the judge can hit them with a $2,000 fine every single time it happens, because the ordinance allows for that discretion.
Okay.
Do we know what they've been fined? Or how many times they've been fined? Do we have any?
No, I can get that, though.
I know how many times, but I don't know what they've been fined.
I think it's 12 times they've been in court. But I'll get the exact numbers.
That'd be great.
Fines.
That's it.
Okay. We're on to matters from the city manager.
I'm done talking.
Matters from the city attorney.
I have no matters at this time.
On to public participation. May I have a motion to open the public comment portion of the meeting with a 3-minute time limit for each speaker?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order. After appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from that speaker.
Jan Sparrow, 2nd Avenue and Words Bookstore. I want to refer back to the zombie walk. Our challenge downtown, and I'm speaking for a lot of the owners, because we've had this problem 2 years in a row, is they close Cookman at noon, and the event doesn't come to Cookman until 5 p.m. So we are stranded with nobody allowed. People are allowed, if they park, I don't know where, to walk down to Cookman. But for the last 2 years, we've all stood around from noon to 5 wondering why the streets are blocked off. We don't have any shoppers because it's so challenging. So I don't know what the solution is per se, other than can the street be kept open until those. I think in some of the other parades, as they're walking towards, they block off the side streets or whatever, and they kind of start to block off in phases. If they could do something like that, or your suggestion about Madison. But our biggest challenge is, why is the street blocked off from noon to 5 and nobody's there walking on those streets? So I guess I'm raising an objection to the fact that, which is unusual for me because I only talk about positive things, right? So I'm like, oh my God, I've got to say this. But I really felt last year we were all very upset as merchants, because we stood around for 5 hours with empty streets. So if some way we could think of a different way to do it, it would be certainly helpful. So I don't know what the suggestion would be other than phases or waves or something. But thank you, and hopefully we can do something differently.
Hello, Council. Anita Weiner, Madison Avenue. I'm going to second the suggestion that it go down Madison Avenue instead of Cookman Avenue, because it seems to be a wider boulevard to walk down, number one. There are less, I think, businesses that are going to be impacted down that street, and you can get to Johnny Mac's from that location just as easily with less disruption to the merchants and the residents in that area. My question maybe for Wednesday would be, could we get an update on what RFPs are out there? Have they been filled? What is the projection for what's happening for the businesses downtown for next year? What's being built? What's being approved? What's not being approved? Just so we get a general idea of what's going through the town, what's happening in the town in the next 6 to 9 months to a year. Thank you. That's it. I'm done.
When you say what's being built?
Well, I mean, I know RFPs go out. That's a request for proposal for certain things you want to have done. So I want to know what RFPs went out. Were they done? And are they going to be done? I mean, it sounds stupid, but, and then in terms of what structures are going to be put in the downtown area, what is the time frame for any of those to be going on? I'm assuming nothing's happening with the Savoy now. On the building on Banks Avenue with all the bricks, that's going to be a residence store retail thing with some sort of parking, I hope. What is that projected to happen? And are there any other stores on businesses on Cookman or in the area that are looking forward to coming in? Thank you.
In regards to RFPs, we don't own any property in the Central Business District. The only property we own is where we're sitting right now in the Transportation Center. We did issue an RFP for developers who'd be interested in redoing these two sites. They're still being reviewed by staff before we even talk to the council about it. But everything else is private sector development that would go before the planning board, the zoning board, or be permitted by right under zoning and then go straight to construction. Anything in that sense, we wouldn't know because you have months before you have to put a shovel in the ground with a building permit, unless they come here under a pilot and then we say you have to have something done.
Okay.
But if you want to see what's happening there, it would be really the planning board agendas.
Okay.
We wouldn't have any of that stuff.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Peter C. Nicolau. I am a volunteer and artist in Asbury Park. One of the organizations I volunteer for is the Jersey Shore chapter of Surf Rider Foundation. Surf Rider and the City of Asbury Park collaborate on successful campaigns year-round, such as beach and lake cleanups, as well as Rise Above Plastics. The current issue I'm bringing to light is litter, receptacles, and recycling. Currently, on the east and west side of Main Street in Asbury Park, from Lake Avenue to Sunset Avenue, there are a total of 21 trash cans. 13 cans are labeled trash and 8 are labeled not at all. There are also no options available on Main Street for recycling, and the distance between most city blocks and available trash receptacles are too far apart or no options at all. The lack of options contributing factors to the amount of pollution on the streets, sidewalks, buildings, inside the base of light posts, as well as nature. Every city generates trash and garbage that require attention on a regular basis to maintain cleanliness, safety, and health in the environment. Having the proper equipment applies to waste management just as it does to other areas of successful city operations. When a city supplies its citizens and visitors with easy access to double-barreled trash/recycling containers, overall maintenance of the city and the surrounding environment is made optimal. Buildings, streets, sidewalks, grass, trees, air, soil, and the water stay cleaner and benefit the entire city as well as the inhabitants of it. The cost associated with providing 3 double-barreled trash recycling containers on every block on Main Street, I estimate to be about $75,000. This number is based on a commercial zone 7272019 ARC-T Parkview 50-gallon black double trash recycling receptacle with decals. Each receptacle is priced at about $529, which does not include shipping and tax. Now, what can we do to help the City of Asbury Park keep litter off the ground and dispose of it properly in a fun, cost, and time-effective manner? Proposed solution, a creative collaboration between the City of Asbury Park, the Jersey Shore Chapter of Surf Rider Foundation, and me to produce a fundraising event with 100% of the proceeds donated to purchase proper receptacles. Every city is special, every city has a need, and we are here to help this city with its special need of adequate receptacles and recycling on Main Street. Thank you for your time and consideration, and we look forward to helping you.
Yeah, and we're going to give you some good news.
Okay. We just authorized the purchase of $40,000 worth of cans. The council in the capital budget for this year put in $25,000 for purchase of cans. We used $15,000 of Clean Communities money. They are on order. They do take some time. And today I met with Madison Marquette that had ordered the additional cans for the boardwalk 2.5, 3 months ago, and they're coming in next week.
Okay.
So in next year's capital plan is an additional $25,000 to keep purchasing cans that are uniform throughout the city. I personally despise the blue barrels. Those annoy me to no end. They're completely unprofessional looking. It's not the image we should have. They're going to be done correctly with blue and black for recycling and trash. It's going to take some time because it's not just Central Business District. It's not just Main Street. The council wants the entire city done the correct way.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's the cost is more than $75,000. It's going to take a couple years, but we're phasing out all the blue cans and putting more cans where they're needed.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate
but
it.
But if you still want to have a fundraiser,
well,
we'll be
I was
there.
Thinking the same thing, but then I was like, where can we appropriate these funds to? If it's
we would do a dedication by rider, which is on the agendas, and then just give us how much money you want.
Okay. Because I want take 40, to 50 all go towards helping the community, whether it be the environment or poverty or whatever it is that we can do, but definitely working together on a plan between Surf Rider and Art Show and the city can really max out benefit for everybody. So,
fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Motion to adjourn public?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn?
Move it. Second.
All in favor?
Yes.